continuum program. Thank you for an introduction, and thanks. I'm grateful to the organizers, Hong, André, Max, and Wijls, that I'm invited here to speak to you today about my research, which is joint work with Marc Pelletier, who is my supervisor, Aliana Garoni from La Sapienza in Rome, and Lucia Scardia. And though my talk sounds quite technical, actually I want to start to the whole opposite side of the spectrum and actually show you an experiment. And that happens here, that's why the slide is blank. So I have a piece of metal wire here. And what happens to it when I bend? Well, then it deforms like this. And I think I cannot surprise you too much with this effect. But still it's quite surprising, actually, why it behaves like this. Because there are, we studied in our mathematics masters how this works in the setting of elasticity. But this effect cannot be described by elasticity. All models of elasticity, even nonlinear elasticity, they fail to describe this. Also, you think, well, maybe when it bends, it behaves a bit like a very viscous fluid or so. But also, those models, they don't give good predictions to the accuracy what you actually are after. Then the question arises, what happens here? And to answer that, we need to zoom in all the way to the microstructure of this piece of steel here, all the way to the scale of the atoms. When we do that, we get such a picture on the right there, where you see an atomic lattice, so all the balls are the atoms, and the lines are the interatomic bonds. We only use the square lattice for conveniences. And then you see also that there's a mismatch somewhere in the middle, which I will call a dislocation. And those appear everywhere in the metal, so they are really very, on the nanoscale they exist. And these are like line defects that span throughout the crystallographic lattice. Now, why are these line defects interesting? Well, when I bend this piece of metal, they all start to, if I bend it a little bit, only a few move and nothing happens. But if I bend it all the way, then then all of them start to move and they start to go to a different place. And that makes this, on the macroscopic scale, so on this wire, this deformation possible. And if I remove the force, then some of them move a little bit, but most of them stay in their new position. And that's why this thing doesn't bend back anymore. And then we get again a piece of steel, which for small deformations behaves elastic. Now this is a more zoomed out picture. This is a more zoomed out picture where the dark areas depict high densities of these dislocations. And you see there typical microstructures arise. So there are these line patterns. Oh, maybe I'll just do it with this stick. There are these line patterns or patterns of high dislocation density. And we like to understand more how we can go from the scale where these individually live to a larger scale like this. So in the end, the whole question that we like to answer is, how can we go from this picture or the smaller one, how can we, the dynamics in there, how can we use the tools from mathematics to predict what happens on a larger scale when I have really pieces of metal. Now, up till now, this could have just been a talk given by an engineer or a material scientist. But as it turns out, they have, of course, worked on this for many years now, and they have come up with different models which predict a different behavior on the macroscopic level, so on this level. So, but since there are different models, it's not so easy to decide which one works best or in what case. So what is really missing here is a more fundamental understanding of how to link the discrete to the continuum. So by the discrete I mean these different dislocations, and on the continuum I mean a density of these dislocations. And that's where we aim to contribute with our mathematical research. So to be a bit more specific, I will narrow down this very complex system of all kinds of dislocation curves, crossing and intersecting and linking to a very easy, well, to a relatively easy model, which still contains interesting features. And here is a picture of this model, where I've arranged all these microscopic mismatch defect in lattice, which I will denote by such a perpendicular sign, into a very regular into a very regular microstructure where these in these types of walls of dislocations, as they are called, that they stretch out periodically in the y direction. And then I also assume that they are nicely aligned on these horizontal so-called slip lanes. And that means that such a wall moves on its own, and in these walls, all these dislocations, they basically feel the same force from all the others. I'll come to that next. So I can consider these, all these walls, actually as particles on a one-dimensional line. And the only type of unknown which is still left here is the horizontal position of these particles. So each of these particles presents such a wall. And now let me tell you how these particles interact, or what is it, what describes the mechanics of this system. Well, the force on particle I is given by an external force. You can interpret that as me bending this material. I put, well, on the micro scale, put a force, but microscopically that's I can say fairly well that's a constant force. And then the most interesting part is the interaction between particles, I and J. I have full interaction, so every pair of particles is taken into account. And the force between two particles, which always repel each other, is given by such a functional. The exact form doesn't really matter, but it is important that there is a singularity at zero and that the tails decay to zero, in this case very fast. But in general, we don't need that for the techniques I will show you. Okay. Then I can put this into a force balance. So I'm going to sit on each particle and ask the questions for equilibrium. What does it mean? That's an equilibrium. Well, that all the forces on the particle add up to zero, and that's what this formula tells me. For each I have a formula, and here the sum is over all j is not equal to I. So these are all the interactions, and j not equal to I means that the particle doesn't interact with itself. The alpha n is a scaling parameter, which basically tells me how large is the interaction force with respect to the externally applied force. And that one contains all the physical parameters. So it's this is a rescaled version. The parameters, these one, the positions are already rescaled such that they have typically size or number of order one. And why this is the correct scaling that I find not intuitive to see from this picture, but I will show you that later. So what can I say more? The alpha n I just told you. In this talk, there are actually many different regimes for what how alpha n scales. Now, why is that? Since I already told you that I've rescaled these to be order one, then it depends what this alpha n is, what part of the graph of phi I'm going to typically see. Is it typically this behavior, or is it typically this one? Or is it actually both? That can also happen, because the difference between those particles ranges from 1 over n to order 1. So I can, in fact, also see the whole part of the graph. And then you can already see, well, that is going to matter if I take a limit in some sense. Yes, Michiel. Yeah, I'm going to an energy formulation, and then if I differentiate and if there's a potential, I get an alpha n in front. That's the only reason I can tell. I'll come to it later. Okay. So this is all a bit abstract. So let me just show you a picture of when I just solved this force balance for a certain alpha n. Then I get typically such a plot. So the boxes here, horizontal position is actually the unknown that I've solved here. But if I put them all on one line, this is hardly visible what's really happening here. So I also given them a vertical coordinate to show the discrete density. It's calculated by this formula, but what it basically says, if I'm a particle, I look at my two neighbors, and the closer they are, the higher the density I feel. So this basically says the density gets higher near the impenetrable boundary. So I haven't told you that, but in the steel, typically steel, well, there's many things to say, but there are these impenetrable boundaries in between, or at least we model them as such. And that's where such a pileup of these particles occurs, and that's where what's a model for what happens here for this deformation. So we are actually interested in describing in more accuracy this type of this part of the whole domain, how the particles pile up there. Yeah, these are these dislocation walls. That's how I. Yeah, this, okay, let me go a bit back because I've been very fast. So the modeling assumption here is that all around here are all the atoms, but I didn't depict them here because here I already took some scaling which is larger than a typical atom scaling, so the atoms are already homogenized out to a continuum. And the only thing which I then see from the presence of a dislocation is a force and a stress field that it induces in the material. And due to this stress field, all the dislocations feel that, and that under this stress field, they tend to go in a certain direction. And that then I call a force on another dislocation. And with this technique, dislocations interact. And if I then do all the summations here over these walls, I get the interaction as depicted here. Does that answer your question? Okay, yeah, well, the stress field that one the particle induces in the crystal stretches throughout the whole crystal. It's further away, it decays, but it decays typically by one over r squared, I don't remember by now. But if I sum them up over the whole wall, somehow these interactions cancel and I only see an exponential decay. But so it is a stress field that causes the non-locality. Yeah? Okay, thank you. Yes, okay. So this was this is typically how they pile up. And now if I use this, I've checked this for alpha and I just put it up to 1, so it's the first case, and n is 16. And if I now do it for different n, I see such a picture occurring. So well, the obvious observation is, well, they all sit on top of each other. So that's actually very nice. And though these are all discrete profiles, there is actually clearly a continuous profile emerging here. So that would say, well, this should be possible to take a limit here and to find this curve. Also, when I take another value for the alpha there, which turns up in the force term, I get, and I do the same numerical experiment, I get a similar type of profile, which shows here the straight line, but here there is... it has a bit of noise. I shouldn't say noise. That's wrong in this audience. Sorry. But here, there's the match is not so great. But I'll come to that. But let me first focus on the bulk behavior where they do arrange nicely. So that's the whole question that I want to focus on first. Is there a generic universal density profile which fits nicely on top of this curve? That is the question I'd like to address now. So how to find it, and then also how to prove that indeed my profiles that are drawn over here converge in some sense to this rho bar, the continuum. Okay. So the problem is so that I have this force balance here that I showed you before. And then basically the question is, can I have some upscaling of this force balance to this one. Now, the point here is, I would not know how to do this directly. Why is that the case? Well, this is an equation in Rn. That's what the superscript n says. It's not a power. It's just to indicate that these objects, this is a vector in Rn, and this is a vector field in Rn. And this should be zero. All components should be zero. But if n increases, this is a set in a different space. It lives in Rn. So if n increases, that's hard to take a limit about. And this will typically be some sort of nonlinear differential equation. So that lives yet again in another space. So I would not know how to make any type of convergence on this set. But what I do know, and what I will use, is that I can, I'm in a lucky case that my force field is conservative. So I can find an energy, this one. And if I would take minus its gradient, I would come back to the force field that I showed you before. Typically, this energy comes with an extra summation sign on both the force, the external forcing term and the interaction term. So this is nothing but the sum of the particles. And the interaction is the double sum indicates a sum over all dislocation pairs. So I get typically n squared many. And the alpha n pops up here again. So I will say more about that, but first let me talk about this interaction potential V, which now looks like this, and is just minus the energy prime, is the force that I showed you before. I have here a specific one from our model, but in general what I will be talking about in my talk holds for general properties of this V, and those properties are that is positive. It is even, it is decreasing, and there comes a very funny one. Its Fourier transform is positive. That I don't find intuitive, and I find it a bit strange, but this is exactly, this will pop up in the argument. I'd like to show you how our proof is going to work. And we need that it integrates up to something finite. Okay. Let me tell you now about this alpha n. I think the scaling makes more sense here, because what it does here, it basically squeezes this profile into on top of this single point if alpha n would be would increase, while keeping the integral the same value. Okay, so let me now go back to the previous question about the force balance when I couldn't solve this. Now, our overview, our strategy is, now this solving this force balance is equivalent to minimizing the energy. And for minimizing an energy, there is a nice framework to pass to the limit and to go to minimize some continuous energy of some density of particles. So this is where the discrete to continuum limit takes place. And how to go back from this minimization problem, I do the Euler-Lagrange equations. And I come back to the force balance in the continuum world where I was interested in to find my continuous profile. So this is going to be the plan, and I'll be mainly focusing on this arrow here. Yeah, so this is, and the thing, this arrow goes by gamma convergence, which also Maria has spoken about, but for me it's in a discrete to continuum framework. But I'll introduce that more easily. For example, I should first tell you what it now means for a discrete profile, or actually a vector in Rn, to converge in some sense to a limit, to a continuous profile row. Well, we do that by narrow convergence, or in probability theory it's called convergence in distribution, if I'm correct. And that's basically by first considering my vector of particle positions as an empirical measure, u, the sum of deltas. And then here is what it means to converge narrowly or weakly or weak star. There are many different names for that. Is by testing with a function in CB, first fixing it and then considering these two integrals. Yeah, if I is 1, then this is a probability measure, but if I is 0, it's not, but it still converges to a probability measure. Yeah, that doesn't matter too much. If I take, okay, to my application, I just use this as an analytical tool, not to be exactly in the space of probability measures. The advantage of I is 0 is I have fixed, I didn't tell you this explicitly, but I fixed one of these walls to be at the barrier where they cannot penetrate, and there it's stuck. So there typically the force balance doesn't hold because the barrier prevents it from moving. So x is 0 is not a variable because it's fixed, but if I take it into here, it's more convenient when I'm going to introduce the energy. No. No, because in this narrow convergence, it doesn't see a single particle. This is just convenient if I'm going to introduce my energy next in terms of mu n to have this one in here. So it's I would say it's an unimportant detail, and don't focus on it too much. If you would rather have seen here one, please do so, and nothing will go wrong. So I now introduced a mu while I was talking about rho, so please forgive me for using rho for a density if mu would happen to be absolutely continuous. And I reserve the letter mu for its measure. I like to make a distinction between the measure and the related density. Okay, so now that I've told you what it means for a vector to converge to a density profile, so that's by the narrow convergence, I can state what the gamma convergence is. I'm not going to, okay, so what typically the gamma convergence, you want to prove two inequalities, lim inf 1 and lim sub 1. Why gamma convergence is because it preserves minimizers, and we are interested that the minimizers of the discrete energy converge to the minimizers of the continuous density, so that's why this one is the most natural thing to look at. Also, what comes along with gamma convergence and what is not stated here is that we would like to have compactness, so that when my discrete energy would happen to be bounded for some sequence mu m, that I can then extract a converging subsequence. Okay, so let's go back to discrete energy and write down three times the same thing but with different notation to reveal some structure. In the first line, I just replace what I've written down before. I take alpha n to be equal to 1, so that one disappears here. I start with the easy case. Then I write these sums in terms of mu in the second line, and then they turn up to be integrals because they are a sum of deltas. I should tell you what this funny symbol is here. Well, it's almost a cross product, but not quite. And not quite is due to removing the self-interactions here. So that's all that it does. And if I want to introduce my favorite notation of these duality pairings again, then I can write it down in this form, where the tilde here is to indicate that I now consider it as a function on R2 and not of R1. This. Okay. So now, what do we know if this function x and this v tilde would have happened to be continuous and bounded? Then, by the definition of narrow convergence, I would have been able to pass to the limit directly. And I would get actually not only a gamma convergence limit, but even something stronger. However, these things are not bounded because, well, this is obviously unbounded, and this one has a singularity. But they are bounded from below, and they are also lower semi-continuous. And then, by the Postmanteau theorem, they do not necessarily converge, but the lim inf of those is of these two terms is separately bounded from below by this term and that term, so just basically removing the n's, And the self-interaction also gets removed because this one weakly converges to this one. And that these two combined, I call, that turns out to be my limiting energy E. This is the whole basis for the Liminf, for the proof of the Liminf inequality, and yes, it is that easy. I am not going to show you the Lim-Sub inequality, because since due to the convexity of this profile, the Lim-Sub inequality, yeah, you basically put the particles as much equispace as possible, and then do some basic manipulations, and it works, but it's more boring than it's fun. So I decided to leave it out for you today. So let me now say, just bluff my way out and say this holds for when alpha n converges to alpha as well, and not only when it's 1. Then I'm going to write down 3 times the same thing again. Just I would say pick the description that you feel most comfortable with. I would say especially this one or this one are nice because they show more structure than details. And we're going to use them later. I didn't say why the a half appears. Well, that's because now I basically count every interaction twice, because this is 2 times a full integral, and that's why that the half does that. Okay. Then it's time to do the Euler-Lagrange equation. Well, that's most clearly seen from this point onwards, I think. Where you can just think about it in the, well, it's not, no, I shouldn't say it's in the L2, but this is what turns out. I basically have the derivative of these parts on the left, with a minus sign. And then if I put the prime into this interaction potential, I come back to this one. Which relates very much to the discrete force balance, which was over here. So these two are in fact extremely similar. So that's in a way boring, because this is kind of what we would have expected, although I would not know how to see that this structure appears from here by taking the limit n to infinity. Yeah, because it doesn't really matter, because here it's 0 anyway, but I put the minus sign because of the force.
No, there's minus 1 minus the thing that you're driving, and yeah. The following line, there's a minus sign.
Yeah, because the prime of V is, why did I do that?
Because it's defined as V of alpha of that minus 1.
Wait a moment, no, it's I have defined V prime to be equal to minus phi. That's how it was by definition. Oh. Not a good question. But this is typical for when you go from energy to force, you put a minus in front, the derivative and minus sign, that's where it occurs. Okay. So now let me just solve this this equation and plot it and see what happens. That's what happens here. And well, it nicely fits. So here I have this straight line that I was longing for, and it perfectly fits through the discrete particles. So, well, that is indeed the result we were looking for. By the way, I should mention, this is not my work. This was done previous to my work by Lucia and Mark and others in Eindhoven. But it still lies at the basis to my work, so I'm coming there, but please bear on with me. But this is a very nice fit. And I'll show you now next, also in the case where alpha n is in between 1 and n, so it goes to infinity with n, but at a smaller rate than n. Okay, the energy looks almost the same, but now there is also this interaction potential depends on n via this in this way. There is this alpha n inside, but to abbreviate, I just put an n as a subscript. Yes. So let me just first try to, by intuitive ways, find the gamma limit. So naively, I have that this Vn converges weakly to a delta and zero multiplied with the integral. because as I told you, this alpha n, when it goes large, it squeezes the profile of V into a single delta peak while it conserves its mass. So this is what would come out. And again, I have in the limit that this this combined measure converges weakly to this one. So this would suggest that if I just plug in the two limits here and also there, I would get this structure here. And then if I take mu to be a density, then this delta basically makes this into a L2 integral of the density squared, and this term remains. But this is just an intuitive argument, because I cannot do that, since if I really want to pass to the limit here, I would need to have a strong convergence here, which means convergence in continuous and bounded functions, so in the L infinity norm. But this clearly does not satisfy that. So then an interesting observation is, well, actually, this is going to be the gamma limit, but only because alpha n is in this range. If alpha n would go faster, then it doesn't work, and we get really a different limit, which is all described in the paper over there, but I will not talk too much about this case. But this observation also shows that this reasoning, where I never used that alpha n is much smaller than n, is not going to work, and it's hard to fix a few details to make it work. So we really need a different type of argument to pass to the limit here in this case. And this I'd like to show you, because this I think is not, at least for me, it was not such an intuitive argument which leads to that, but it can be very powerful, as it reveals a lot of structure in here. And that's what I want to show you on the next slide. So what we really try to do is to reveal that this thing here has a quadratic structure. It now already seems somehow the case, because mu appears twice in somehow a quadratic way. But this Vn is in between, and that all makes an interaction, and then it's not so easy anymore to see that it is indeed quadratic. And we need more assumptions on that. Yeah, Michiel. Yeah, I'll come to that. You'll see what I mean by quadratic structure. But I'm indeed very vague at this point. So what we do first is, this singularity is a bit nasty. What I can do is just cut it off in such a way to approximate my V by a Vm, which is saying at the height m, I just continue in a straight way, affinely, and then I hit some finite value for every fixed m. And then I can estimate this duality pairing, or the whole interaction term of the energy, from below by this term, where I include the self-interactions, so I have to subtract them again. And here I see this is not going to work when alpha n scales with n or larger. And this is a finite value for a fixed m, and I keep m fixed for the moment. Okay? And now comes the funny part. I'm really going to use this thing as a positive Fourier transform. You can prove that if they are even convex and converging to zero, then the Fourier transform is positive. Also, hence also for Vm, because it still has all these properties, which is inherits from V. And that's why also the way how I cut short the singularity matters a lot. And you have to do it in the right way, because otherwise what I show next is not going to work. So now in the next line, I'm going to show you why it's important to have the Fourier transform positive. Well, because we can take then square roots of it, and Fourier inverse to get some W. And this W is going to satisfy, by the rules of Fourier transforms, that W convoluted with itself is equal to V. Yeah, so and then if I would plug that in over here, this Vmn, I can also define in a Wm in the same way. And this n is just this, that there's some alpha n's inside. Then I can rewrite this by changing some integrals into this. And that's what I mean with by a quadratic form. Because here I have the two norm of mu n convoluted with Wmn. And that is very nice. because we, for the Lim-Inf inequality, we can assume that, that this thing is finite. Well, this is just a constant going to zero in our case. So hence, if this thing is finite, then Wmn convoluted with mu n converges weakly in L2. Well, that's just basically over here. And then to identify the limit, I can go to a very weak sense of convergence where I just multiply by a smooth test function. And then I can find out that the limit, in fact, is mu times the integral of Wm, which by Fourier transforms is just equal to the square root of the integral of Vm. And that this thing is in L2 also means that my measure here is in L2, so it has a density, and the density is in L2. And this is, well, this is basically the way we pass to the limit and Lim-Inf inequality. So the main point is here that I wanted to show you is how this positivity of the Fourier transforms can be used to transform this into a quadratic structure over here, and that is very good to get for the Lim-Inf inequality. And later I'll show you how we use it again. So to wrap up, we get this term as a limiting energy, which looks easier than the previous time. I'll use a small letter A for the integral of V because I will be using it more times. Well, the Euler-Lagrange equation looks suspiciously easy because, the solution is just a straight line. And then when it hits the x-axis, it's being continued by zero because the Euler-Lagrange equation only needs to hold on the support of rho. And then I can plot it, and well, again, it fits fairly well, our straight line onto the profile, save for this point here, but the bulk is captured quite well. So, and what I will be doing next is what I also alluded to previously. We still see that here, well, things are not matching up that well. So that's what I'll be focused on next. Here I made I zoomed in on the on this part, and there you can see, well, the red ones don't do so bad. They go to the black profile, and after this point, it, it fits well. It's still for the same number of n's, and alpha n I've taken here to be the square root of n. But still, I see some, already the red ones, they show already some profile, again some generic profile. That's the question. Well, can we do the same trick again? Well, but then the profile should be different for all these, so most likely I need to rescale it. And I do need to rescale it, but I don't know by what. And luckily, there is Cameron Hall has been working on this in Oxford, and he is an expert in asymptotics, matched asymptotics from discrete to continuum. And by these methods of making an asymptotic expansion, collecting terms of the same size, he has been able to derive that the boundary layer should be of size 1 over square root n, alpha n is square root n. So okay, we can just test it. We stretch the profiles of rho n by square root n. And what happens? Well, they all nicely suddenly fit on the same line again. So he was right. It's, people from asymptotics usually are. except for here, but then you can say, yeah, but this is the bulk at this is the bulk at work, and the bulk was already properly scaled. So if I'm stretching the bulk out of its equilibrium, I get that it diverges here. So maybe it's better to just subtract it by this one, and then we arrive at such a picture where there is, well, they all fit. So when I did this picture myself, and this was the first output I got, so I have some emotional attachment to this picture. I did not know that it was going to fit so well. So, well, whoever is going to say there wouldn't be a continuous curve anymore. So here, really, this picture was like, okay, now there should be a continuous curve. It's only a matter of time before we find it. Yes, well, that's again the question I'll pose again. But now it's not the density, it's something funny. This new n stretches out the density, so actually this on itself is not does not integrate up to 1. It integrates up to the square root of n. And well, so this new n is some difference between two density profiles, which is not so easy to interpret, and I don't have a nice interpretation either, other than the mathematical definition. This is done for different alpha n, so maybe you think it's because alpha n is exactly the square root of n, but no, also when I plug in these and do for the three different things the simulation, for n is 2^8, the profiles still fit nicely. So again, everything is on the same universal curve, and hence I'd like to find the curve. Also, I haven't told you that, why are we so interested in that curve? Well, as I told you, this bending is mostly described by the high densities, and exactly our continuous density doesn't predict the high density close to the boundary, and that's why we'd like to have a better approximation of the density profile. Okay, so again the question, how to find this profile nu bar? Well, now it's not so so trivial how to do that. And the typical strategy is some refined gamma convergence. Also, Maria has talked about that this morning. By what we basically do is we subtract the minimal value of the energy, and then we blow up the energy difference around equilibrium. That is how I would say it. I'm basically looking more at the how does the valley look where the equilibrium lies. So for that to zoom into, I have to subtract the eventual limiting value of the energy, such that my the bottom of the well is at the value 0, and then I can blow it up by a value beta n, which I do not know a priori and have to find. And then I get more information about what really happens in the valley, and maybe then I can get an improvement on the minimizer as I had it already. Well, now I'm going to have to disappoint you, because this problem turns out to be very tough, and that is at least from our perspective due to the discreteness. But we still are hopeful that we can prove it, and this is work in progress with Cameron and also with Tom Hudson, who is in the audience. So what can we do? Well, here's an overview profile of the things I've been discussing about so far. I have told you this that En gamma converges to E alpha. That was the first part that I discussed. The one with a slightly more involved proof was En converging to the limit energy E. And I've shown you the pictures of that, and that was all done in an article before me. And what I will do now is, instead of doing a refined gamma convergence on this arrow, I'm going to do a refined gamma convergence here. So where I first take the discrete to continuum limit here, and then consider this alpha which pops up there, to which is still in the interaction potential, take that to infinity, and then try to refine the gamma limit here. Proving gamma convergence of this to this is not hard, so I won't show it to you. And in the end, then we need to look at this object, f alpha of nu alpha, which is the difference between these two guys, multiplied by something which grows large. I already revealed to you that this is going to be alpha. And now we try to prove that this indeed gamma converges to f. And then hopefully, once we minimize this f, we would get the profile I was hoping to find. So let me try to convince you why this is not a bad idea. So we want to circumvent the discreteness difficulties. And if I look at the continuous version, so the E alpha, then it looks very much like the discrete energy. I only remove some n's here. Exactly, only on the place where the mu is. I only remove some superscripts, and the energies are actually the same. And also from this profile, you see the match is so good, there should not be too much difference between these two. Of course, I can just say this is the case, but actually this requires a proof which I don't have at the moment. But it is an indication why it is not a bad why it makes sense to consider this one first. And that's what I will do next. So towards this gamma convergence, it's a good idea to first clean up the expression of f alpha. What do I mean by that? I first add and subtract this one, because it is easier to consider this energy difference. So I plug in the continuous profile, or I mean the minimizer of the energy E into the energy E alpha. And then this term is just a constant because it doesn't depend on nu, my variable, while rho bar is it's known. That's the straight line. So what I can also say, what I've alluded to before, this nu alpha is defined by stretching out the densities by a factor alpha. And that would mean that the integral is zero. No, it's not a probability measure, not at all. And also, that is bounded from below, because this one is fixed, and this one is positive, and this one is a straight line. So I have a strict lower bound on the negative part of mu. And that's going to help a lot in treating this the gamma, getting the gamma convergence result. So I'm not going to tell you how to clean up f exactly, because that's a boring computation. But what is the strategy in this computation? We substitute this rho by our variable nu and the rho bar, which we have explicitly. Then we use explicitly the profile of rho bar, which is not that hard, and a positive integral. And then we minimize the appearance of alpha. And then we come finally at this formula for f alpha. Which is nice, because the first two terms do not depend on alpha at all. And the first two terms turn out to be also the gamma limit. And here is some extra term, which is staying small. It's a small perturbation. Of course, we need to prove that it actually is. And that I was going to do next. So I can, of course, by cleaning up this f alpha, you get a bit of a feeling what can be the gamma limit, and that's what I aim to do here. Okay, so what I will focus on in the gamma limit proof is mainly the compactness, and from that argument it follows also how you can do the gamma limit. Again, I won't talk about the lim sub, because that is that goes by the normal argument. So for compactness, we really needed to work hard and have a good idea on how to do it. Okay, so the statement about compactness is bounded energy. How does it imply compactness, and in what topology does it do that? Well, so I've written down f alpha here again. Now I will talk about more about what this h alpha is. Well, the h alpha is this dashed line here, straight. Then it goes straight and to a very long way, to 2 alpha square root a. But remember that it scales with alpha, so it's zero in a very large interval. And then it increases linearly again by this formula. But the real H alpha is also a convolution with V of that graph, so that's why this black line, how it comes into play, it's somehow a smoothened out version. This 1 over 2a is just because that's the integral over V from minus infinity to infinity, so then basically this is integral 1. Then we can show by these properties that I listed here that this is indeed bounded from below, and by the property of mu. And then to make that precise, we need to have an extra condition on V, which is that its first moments are bounded. I didn't require that before for the zeroth order gamma limit, but to identify this the zoomed in, if we find gamma convergence, I'll need it. Okay. Let me focus now on the other terms. The interaction term, I can use the same strategy as before. I can again define such a W, and since now everything is continuous, I don't need to worry about the self-interaction. So I can immediately write it as this quadratic form, and this convolution here of W with nu alpha, I'm going to call that lambda alpha. And then I have immediately in that this term can be substituted by the by an L2 norm squared of this lambda alpha. So now if I somehow combine this by the L2 norm of lambda alpha, then I'm in good shape. And indeed, that turns out to work well. Therefore, we also need to have an alpha an estimate on U alpha. That requires a few steps. And then I can, this is, note that this inequality is an implicit one, because lambda alpha depends on U via this, by its very definition. So this is one of the key estimates, but it's not so, it requires some basic manipulations. And then once we have this estimate, that nu alpha is bounded on every compact set K, we can deduce this, that we can bound this term here, which appears over there, by a constant times a constant times lambda alpha, the L2 norm of that. And then that is very good, because then I can combine these terms, C bigger equal than that, bigger equal than lambda alpha squared times a small constant, minus maybe a large constant, but that doesn't matter. I have now that the L2 norm of lambda alpha is bounded. And hence, lambda alpha converges weakly in L2. And since this one is bounded, also nu is bounded on compacta. And that means that it converges in the vague topology to nu. Now what is the vague topology? That is not testing against continuous and bounded functions, but testing against continuous functions that have compact support. And then they are automatically bounded, but it's a weaker convergence than the narrow topology that I showed before. And what it basically does, it allows for the profile nu to, at infinity, do whatever it likes. And that corresponds quite naturally to our setting, because we want to approximate this boundary layer, where we don't care anymore what happens in the bulk region. Okay, so the limit turns out to be this guy, which I can write like this. Then I can do again the Euler-Lagrange equation, which turns out to be, it follows from this line here. We get this one. Now I'd like to solve it for nu bar, which I do, for me that was not trivial actually. But I do that by a collocation method. So basically I substitute this nu bar by a step function, which is constant on intervals, constant with bi on intervals that I specify beforehand. Then I plug that in here and I evaluate it on the midpoints of the intervals, which gives me n equations for the n unknowns here. And then I can solve that that system of linear equations. And if I then get the profile and plot it, look what happens. Ah. That was, again, I was surprised that it fits so well, that's a good question. Whether this, we are still struggling with that. It's tough to show that it's even bounded from below, that it satisfies this this condition that is always larger than minus rho bar. That's a very good question, though. I would say rho bar, this is the condition that any nu here should be larger than minus rho bar and zero. And the reason that I show rho bar and zero is nice, because this is somehow the only information that is left from the bulk. We only need to have what the density is at the point zero, not even its derivative. And somehow that's the only thing that remains here in this equation. Thank you. But indeed, you're right. We have problems in showing that the solutions have good properties. Why? Because convoluting with this V somehow kills high Fourier modes. I not know the details, but very tough to exclude high oscillations from this nu bar from happening. I would, for example, take two delta peaks, which are at the opposite sign, which are very close. That gives only a very minor contribution to the energy, while of course it's disastrous for any properties of the solution. But still, that's also surprising but why the numeric still works, but it does, because it perfectly fits the profile, and it's computed in a very different way than these discrete particles, which are just produced by solving the system for a very large n, and then rescaling afterwards. So that's somehow a validation of why these, that it should be true, but it's only numeric so far. Okay, so then I can ask the question, now this line is rather abstract, what does this now mean for my profile here, where I have the rho bar? Well, now I can increase rho bar because I have my new bar. And then I get these lines. Oh well, they fit actually very nicely. So you should say, well, but the purple one doesn't. No, it doesn't, because that's only done for 8 particles, and I'm zooming in here on a boundary layer. Well, that's the boundary layer consists of exactly 3 particles here. That's not too much. So it's a bit also too much to show that it should also converge here. But if I go to more and more particles, this fits perfectly, as I showed you in the previous plots. And now we have, because now we have a good description of what happened here, which we didn't have before, and that gives more information about what our model predicts for this for the bending of the metal. So one more word about of a reflection of what we did, whether it's really good. Well, we did now this, but actually we want to have the double arrow over here. And that was that's work in progress. And the difficulty, because you can say, well, now you have to continue, you just plug in the sum of deltas and it should be fine. Well, we use quite much this relation here, that this new is decomposable in a positive and a negative part, where the negative part is bounded from above by this rho bar. But that I don't know the discrete counterpart of that. And that's what is causing problems. Okay, so back to the very ultimate goal, the big picture. Have we gotten any further in this question? Well, unfortunately, the answer is hardly. because this model is still very easy, but still we know more about the predictive power of this very easy model, what it can say about this. And furthermore, I hope that we kept our V quite general, so for many interacting particle systems, we can show the techniques on how to do the upscaling. So what we ultimately like to do is to go to the fully three-dimensional setting where these dislocations are curves in a 3D crystallographic lattice, also including thermal fluctuations. I have to apologize if my talk was fully deterministic, there was no stochasticity in it. I still hope that the techniques that I use are somehow somehow useful or can be used to the advantage in treating also stochasticity. And it's also on the to-do list, thermal fluctuations. So let me end you by saying what our current research is. It's actually, the list is starting to grow long, which is good for me, I have stuff to do. And there's... I'm also happy that the organizers brought together different people whom I work together with. So, like Marco Morandotti, who speaks tomorrow. And there is Tom Hudson, who speaks this Friday. I'm not the only one working on this topic. There are actually more people working on here. Also, Tony Lilievre, also in the audience. And on different type of topics. Because this is really a multi-scale problem. It's not only the scale from dislocations to this piece. Actually, in between, there's another multi-scale problem. There's also going from the atoms to the dislocations, which I haven't told anything about, but which Marco and Tom will tell you more about. And also other work, but I'll leave this here to read for you. And meanwhile, I'll thank you for your attention.
Yes.
And exactly the
Yeah?
Environmental
yes. Yes. Well, so they, okay, so these, they do not exactly fit, they're not going to sit exactly on top of each other. Also, I should say that very quickly I went through the scaling, but this is the physical positions where I go to mathematical, then I rescale also the positions by factor n or alpha n or I don't know. So if they are close together, maybe in reality they're still a finite distance apart. I've done, maybe I should tell you this. I've done also the, coming back from our continuous prediction, what this would mean for the physical dislocations, how far are they apart for the physical range of parameters. And the answer is this is indeed slightly too high of a density, but still it's they are the finite range. Within the order of 10 to the power minus 10, which is smaller than nanoscale, so that's a bit too tricky. But we are somewhere close to the right range. But this is still, again, I have to say this is a very simplified model. So it wouldn't have too much predictive power. But the tools we use, they can also be used when we treat this in two dimensions. And hopefully they will be useful also for other generalizations. Does it answer your question? Okay, thanks. Thank you.